In order to bring about the lasting welfare and benefit of beings, establish all of these beings and the awakening of Buddhahood, we should now set out to listen to the instructions on the 5 points of Mahamudra, this profound path, as it has been pointed out, as it has been explained by the 8th Kamakamudra. The first step of these 5 parts of Mahamudra is declaring for refuge or putting ourselves under the protection of the 3 rare and precious ones, the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. To that end, let us now imagine how they are truly present in front of us in space. The Buddha, surrounded by the Sangha, the realized bodhisattvas, and the Dharma as their awakened awareness. All together with all sentient beings who are in the equal position as we are being caught up in the cycle of existence, we imagine now how we go to refuge for these, how we put ourselves under their protection from now on until the very moment till we ourselves achieve the awakening of Buddha.
A further part of this first step, this first part of Mahamudra, is the giving rise to the enlightened attitude. To that end, we remind ourselves of the fact that all sentient beings, not a single one excluded, in one lifetime or other, have invariably been our loving and kind mothers. To bring about their lasting welfare and benefit, we could, in order to do so, we could now decide to travel the path of the Dharma which leads to the awakening of full Buddhahood, and we could strive while doing so to bring about the awakening of full Buddhahood, not only for ourselves but for all of these beings. In order to do so, we give rise to this attitude, which is the so-called bodhicitta or the attitude of aspiration. If we then were to proceed along this path and put into practice the profound path of Mahamudra, coupled with all sorts of beneficial actions for the sake of all sentient beings, that would be the application of that would be the bodhicitta or enlightenment of application. Now, putting these two into practice, we should then train ourselves in what is called the 4 limitless thoughts and recite these together. we were to do so, for instance, we would imagine that above our heads there appears a throne that is being carried by eight lions, upon which there is a lotus flower with a sun. On top of this seat sits the Kamaka. On his head there is the black Vajra crown. In his hands he holds the Vajra bell. They are crossed across of his chest, and he is clothed in the three Dharma robes. His legs are in cross position, and we imagine how full of compassion he regards all sentient beings. If we have imagined to come up and clearly like this above our heads, we then want to quietly pray to him by way of using this name mantra Kamaka Cheno. We would then afterwards imagine how we receive the four empowerments of Kamaka. We would imagine how from his forehead white light radiates, which dissolves into our foreheads, imparting upon us the blessing and inspiration of his enlightened body. From his throat, red light radiates, dissolving into our throats, and we receive blessing and inspiration of his speech. From his heart, deep blue light radiates, dissolving into our own hearts, and we imagine how in this way we receive the blessing and inspiration of the Kamapas, awakened awareness. Then simultaneously we imagine how from his forehead, throat, and heart, blue, red, and light, simultaneously dissolving into our own free places, and in this way we receive the blessing and inspiration that enables us to realize Mahamudra itself. After this, we then imagine how the Kamaka dissolves into light, completely dissolves into us, and becomes inseparably one with his enlightened awareness, and we simply rest in that way.
Nin
The third of the five parts of Mahamudra is the practice which is known as the development process of meditation. During such meditation, also known as Charyamim practice in Tibetan, one imagines oneself to be in the shape of a Idam deity, or any given meditation of deity. This is a direct antidote against our clinging to our bodies, against our constant wish to again and again re-embody ourselves in our bodily form, in any bodily form for that matter. And it is an antidote against all the negativity that has been accumulated by our having a body and acting in the world and on the basis of having such a body. All the veils of aspirations, all the defilements which are based on our bodily form, which are based on the activities which we perform in such a body, will equally be purified, but particularly the clinging to these, clinging to constantly having a bodily form, constantly re-embodying oneself in such a way. To that end, one could employ any of the many various Yidam practices, and it does not matter which one one uses, each of them are equally appropriate to bring about that goal. But just to choose from among the many there are, let us for now, in order to train in this together, choose the form of the one who is the embodiment of all the compassion of all enlightened beings, of all Buddhas, the great compassionate one, Chandrasi, or other potential arises. If we were to perform that practice, we would imagine how Chandrasi in a single instant appears above our heads, sitting upon a lotus, flower, and moon disc, how he sits there with brilliantly white body color with one face and four hands, and which has several times explained over the course of the last couple of days. You would imagine how then from his body, predominantly from his heart region, light radiates. His light first pervades all the Buddha realms, all the realms of the enlightened beings, and it attracts their blessing and inspiration. His blessing and inspiration is being sent back by them in the form of the very same light which is being reabsorbed by the radiation above our heads. Then we would imagine how yet again light radiates from Chenrezig, this time pervading all the six realms of all beings, and changing the entire outer world, these realms, into a pure Buddha. At the same time, all the beings which inhabit these realms are equally pervaded by this light, and they themselves now take on the shape of Chenrezig figures, as we ourselves also do. There is that Chenrezig above our heads, we ourselves appear as Chenrezig, and we are surrounded by countless Chenrezigs, and we will then afterwards, together with all of these beings, repeat the mantra. We now imagine how the entire outer world, which has taken on the form of this world, how all of this outer world and all the beings that inhabit this world, which have taken on the forms of so many Chenrezigs, how all of these
tonight and dissolve them to the chinrezig above our heads. After this, we imagine how this chinrezig above our heads dissolves into light and dissolves into ourself. We ourselves, as chinrezig, then also completely dissolve, and we then simply let our minds rest in this naturally empty state.
And all of this brings us to the This particular short instruction by the third Kama, the single word of path advice from Mahamudra, starts out with the with a homage to all the exalted masters of the lineage, all the great, holy, and sacred masters are we prostrate to, we pay homage to them. And it goes on to say that that which is the realization or the awareness of the Buddhas of the three times, that which is at the awakened heart of all the masters of the past, that which is known as the widely renowned and famous Dharmakaya Mahamudra. This Dharmakaya Mahamudra is nothing else but your own mind, nothing else but your own consciousness. So that which has forever been the intention of all Buddhas, of all enlightened masters, namely the great awakening, the awakening of Buddhahood, which is nothing else but Mahamudra. If we were to ask ourselves, what is this Mahamudra that everybody is so interested in, that everybody wants to know about? If we were to look at it from this point of view, Mahamudra is basically nothing else but our very own mind. If we were to ask ourselves, this mind of ours, this consciousness of ours, what is that? And it is being said here in Ranjan Bhaji's text, your mind or consciousness, if we were to ask ourselves what is the essence of it, then Ranjan Bhaji says, it is exactly that mind of ours which constantly thinks this and that. Everything that could possibly be perceived, either within samsara or nirvana, everything that could possibly appear or exist within either of these, is based solely upon this mind of ours. There is no other source for either of these anywhere whatsoever. Everything that is being explained within the, as it is called, the Tripitaka, the collection of teachings and instructions as they are based upon sutras and tantras and so forth, everything that could possibly be put forth within these, just even the fact that these themselves do appear, have been taught, all of this is solely based within our own minds, does not come from anywhere else. So in this way, the basis for everything, samsara, nirvana, and everything that could conceivably exist within these is our mind, our own mind, and nothing else. Oh, and then I forgot to say, if we were to train in this, if we were to familiarize ourselves with this fact, then there is no particular method whatsoever. There is no talk anymore about practicing, about concerning oneself with meditations, visualizing one's body in the shape of this or that deity and so forth. There is no more talk of that whatsoever. We simply let our minds rest within that natural state.
So if there really is no particular way how to train this, how then do we train? The third Kamapa Ranjan Dorje says, simply rest in this vividly awake awareness. And if we simply let this happen, if we simply rest this awake, this vividly awake awareness, then there is no doubt or no question in our minds anymore. Then there is no necessity whatsoever to ask ourselves, is this Mahamudra? Or maybe not. All of such ideas and concepts will have been exhausted, will have dissolved at this particular point. There is no particular need to be doubtful about it. Simply let go within this awake, vividly awake awareness, and simply let it be like that. Undoubtedly, at some time or other, all sorts of thoughts, ideas will come up within the mind again. But there is no point at all to do anything about them. There's no point whatsoever to, in any way, abandon them or subdue them. Simply perceive them out of this awareness. Let rest within this awareness and simply let it be at that. At this particular point, there's also no reason whatsoever to harbor any ideas of hope or fear. There's no reason to hope for any improvement, nor is there a reason to fear any deterioration whatsoever. Simply let go within this vividly awake awareness of that
fact.
So
中国亚拉当然是南京美食，最早的扩展吧，最早的干嘛不说啊？从那拉酒吧没动过，等到我装了，给那老农说啥呢？咱俩把这个人话也，太麻烦了，别说了，马蹄吧，干家人，他在太麻烦了，把别家就说了，马蹄，嗯，一般的农村都基本利用干农在保护。
If one proceeds in this particular way, if one practices like this again and again, then eventually the nature of thoughts and ideas will dawn upon itself, and all habitual tendencies, concepts as pertaining to these will be completely exhausted. There will be no clinging on to ideas or to concepts anymore. There will be no more influence of habitual tendencies under the influence of which we presently find ourselves. And in this way, we will then achieve the complete awakening of Buddhahood. It is being said that if one were to proceed in this way, then there is no doubt that eventually this will come to pass. As it is said, one moment makes the difference. In one moment, complete perfect awakening or complete perfect Buddhahood. This is that which is called Buddhahood. To bring about such awakening, to rest within this awakening, to irreversibly having achieved that state. This is nothing else but that which is known as Buddha. Now this, Ranjan Dorje says, this single word of heart advice of Mahamudra is that which is at the heart of all the lamas and mahasiddhas. It is that which all the masters, siddhas, all the sacred ones strive for this particular realization. However, this is an instruction of such profundity that it is not to be given to those who have not reached the appropriate maturity for it. Those who are not ripe, who are not mature to appreciate this teaching, this instruction, to them this should not be given. It is said if the the door of secrecy, as it is called literally here, is being breached, then all the good, all the positive that could possibly be achieved through this instruction will simply evaporate and one will not be able to receive its blessing and inspiration. Therefore, as Ranjan Dorje said, keep it secret. Keep it only among those who have directly received this instruction. Do not give it or tell of it to others. And then he closes with the words, this single word of heart advice has been composed by Ranjan Dorje at the secluded place or at the retreat place of Yangon. And this is exactly what is to be done by us now. Simply let go, simply rest in this vividly awake awareness and look at your consciousness, look at your mind nature and see what there is to be seen. So allowing our awareness to rest simply in itself, by itself, in this way, then we should look at this awareness, at this mind of ours, as to whether or not it has a color, or we should possibly look at as to whether or not it has a shape. Does it come from anywhere? Does it go anywhere? Does it rest anywhere in between? This is what needs to be looked at.
Yoga Chalin Kamandu. Kadoga Chalin Mundu.
And looking in this particular way, if we come to conclude that there is no shape to this awareness, to this mind of ours, that it does not have any color, that it does not come from anywhere, nor dwell anywhere, nor go anywhere, if we indeed see that there is nothing whatsoever to be seen, then this is nothing else but the empty essence of our own awareness, of our own minds. And to rest simply in that, this is what needs to be done. Now, having received this profound instruction, we could let our awareness simply rest in itself, by itself, during whatever activity we have to perform, during our daily works, during our daily wheelings and dealings and so forth. Whenever we remember this instruction, we should simply let our awareness rest in itself, by itself. If we were to proceed in this way, there is nothing higher, no greater, no more profound instruction that we could possibly ever receive.
Particularly
in moments when we find ourselves under the influence of strong emotions, this instruction is to be practiced. For instance, if we find ourselves under the influence of great anger, hatred for that matter, looking at our awareness at this particular point, we can transform this anger. This anger would then be transformed into what is called mirror-like wisdom or mirror-like awareness. In this way, practicing in such a way, it would become a great enhancement of our
practice.
Now, if you proceed to practice in this particular way, then invariably at some time or other, we will definitely make various experiences during our practice. We might have experiences of great happiness, of great bliss, of great pleasure. Such experiences are, so to speak, the side effects of such practice. They are rather pleasurable experiences, but it is important in this particular point to remind ourselves that we should not in any way whatsoever cling to them. Simply continue with the practice as you have been instructed, and simply let it be at that. Do not cling to all of these pleasurable experiences or even wish for them to repeat themselves.
And
this brings us to the fifth and final point of the five parts of Mahamudra, which is that of dedication. Now, in our particular text here by the 8th Gamapa Mikha Dorje, he goes into quite some detail concerning these points. But there is no time yet to explain all of these explicitly. Therefore, Rinpoche says he will not particularly do this. We should simply remind ourselves of the significance of dedicating the merit as we usually do it. Having taught these five points of Mahamudra over the course of the last couple of days, our having come here and listened to this instruction, these instructions,
There is so much inherently good within this, so much positive within this, that a great amount of merit has been accumulated by way of doing so, by way of Rinpoche's teaching, the way of our listening.
So
therefore, this merit, we could use this source of benefit for all sentient beings. We could dedicate that merit, which has been accumulated in this particular way, for this sake and the lasting welfare of all beings, coupling this with the wish that they will, in a single lifetime, achieve the unified state of Vajradhara, Vajracham, and in this way, simply dedicate all that merit as has been accumulated over the course of these instructions. If there are some among you who do not know how to go about such dedication of merit, we could remind ourselves of the great examples of the great bodhisattvas such as Manjushri, Samantabhadra, or Avalokiteshvara. In the same way as they constantly have, as they have and constantly do dedicate merit, in the very same way we should go about dedicating. Now, having said all that, now the moment has come to dedicate all the merit that we have accumulated for the sake of all beings.
Thank you.